Good evening, friends. This is Dr. APURV Mehra, and with me is Professor Matthew Varghese, and we are going to discuss about something which is very, very important for the nation today, for the young doctors today. And imagine I, as a teacher, get up at 11 o'clock with a phone in the night that, sir, the situation in the hospital is very troublesome. Many of our friends, our relatives are being screened, and there are in the society people asking us, being a healthcare professional, are you sure you're not suffering from coronavirus? Sir has been going to the hospital and doing emergency cases himself. Some words from you, sir, in these testing times for young people. They want to hear to a mentor like you. They want to understand, do we stay away at our houses, or do we go out right in the front and help the society? That's what we took the Hippocrates oath for. That is what my blood tells me, go and serve our own people. That is what we stayed in this country. Sir, people want to listen to what you want to say.
Yeah. Thank you, APURV, for introducing the topic. It's very important that we recognize our responsibility as physicians. We have taken a Hippocratic oath, irrespective of what is the disease and who the disease is affecting, we have a responsibility to take care of that patient, irrespective of anything. However, having said that, are we going to be heroic and ignore the safety norms? No. We have a responsibility. People say it's a risky thing to do? No. When we took on the profession, when we did the Hippocratic Oath, we took on the flowers as much as the bricks that could come our way. It is part of our responsibility and we have to fulfill it. When an army man takes and dresses in the army outfit, he's prepared for the worst, he's also prepared for the best. Does he go without any preparation? He doesn't go. He goes with training and full preparation. Similarly, we have to be there. So first thing, should we stay at home? No. We have a responsibility professionally. We have a responsibility ethically. We have a responsibility socially, to ensure that no patient that comes to our institution goes back without the care that he needs, without the dignity that he deserves as a human being. It's important we take care of that. But while we are doing that, there are norms for safety for yourself. Because if you are safe yourself, you can take care of more people. So you do not ignore the norms. This is a new virus. We are still understanding hows and whys of it. People do not know the epidemiology. People are still speculating what is it that is making the virus. There are theories. There are explanations. If you go out and read in the literature, plenty of it is there. Why it spreads so easily? I'm not going to go into the technicalities of it. I'm going to the social aspect of that virus. It is spreading, and it is spreading easily, and it is spreading not just to the people that are traveling, not just to the people that are poor, but the who is who in the world is getting affected. So there is something about the virus which is unique, and we still need to understand. We are in the learning process. However, our microbiologists, our microbiology training has taught us, how do we install safety norms when we are doing a procedure? What are the safety norms? The safety norms are, one, the personal protective equipment. Now, there has been a crisis of personal protective equipment that are required for these situations. The important thing that is there in this is, you have to screen first. Does the patient belong to a category where he is likely to be COVID positive? Those questions are triage questions, and those questions are simple Have you been to an area which has been affected by the epidemic of COVID? Number one. Yes or no? Second question. Do you have fever?
Right.
Third question. Do you have cough?
Right.
Without expectoration, usually dry cough.
Right.
And fourth question is, do you have breathlessness?
Right.
If the answer to all these are positive, then you would suspect him to be COVID positive and send him for testing.
Right.
And then quarantine if he is not yet quarantined. So those are the norms. So what do we do? When you're triaging, do you have to have all the protective equipment? The simplest method is to keep a distance.
Right.
Normally, it's about a meter that is recommended. We're still understanding the aerosol transmission of this virus.
Right.
We keep a distance, maybe 1.5 meters, at best 2 meters, and ask the questions to the patient. It can be even on a computer, you can ask the questions. If it is positive, then send him for testing. If you're physically handling body fluids and the examination, say for example, you're an ENT surgeon, look into the throat, you're a dental surgeon, looking into the mouth, and possibility of aerosols are there, you're a chest physician, you're looking at a patient at close quarters, then you need to have the personal protective equipment which is required. And those include a hood for the hair, a mask for the face, and if you're actually doing any other procedure like the anesthesiologist is doing intubation, then you need to have visors so that those splashes don't come onto you, and a gown and leggings. So these are the standard personal protective equipment which is required. A lot of people panic that they don't have it. They have seen a patient, they don't get the virus like that. They don't have to worry about that. So only two things that are evidence-based. One is hand washing. Why? Because a person who has the disease, who is excreting viruses, would have excreted onto his hands. And he would be touching here and there, which you go and touch. And we have a tendency, normal human tendency, researchers, behavioral scientists have found that they touch their face at least 20 times in an hour. 20 times in an hour. So we get out of this habit of touching this T area, our eyes, our nose and our mouth. So that's the T area that you must avoid. The recommendation that we tell people is, don't try to get your hand above your shoulder level. That's when you do that. And don't touch commonly touched areas, doorknobs, railings, switches with your hand and fingers, because we do intuitively. We are designed, evolutionary biology is to take our hands to our face, and we will do that. So do this protection along with, if at all you have to do that, wash your hands. Washing with soap and water is far safer than alcohol. There's a reason for that. Because the virus has a lipid coating, and the lipid coating gets washed away easily with soap. It doesn't stick to your skin easily when there is a soap there. Whereas alcohol, you would put little here, little there and rub. It may not have gone to your interdigital spaces. It may not have gone sufficiently to kill the virus onto you. So there's a huge hype of hand sanitizer not there. How can we work? No. Soap and water is as efficient, perhaps more efficient than alcohol. That's one. Wear your mask. If you're interacting on a day-to-day patient with cough and other things, it's actually more protective the person who's wearing it and who has the disease. The person who's listening, if you keep the distance, that is sufficient. So don't worry. So first message is, don't panic if you have seen a patient of COVID. Don't panic if you have to care for it. It is our social responsibility. However, while we care, we take the safety measures. If you don't have personal protective equipment, don't go in and do procedures and do things. That's not a question of bravado. That's being foolhardy. I have heard residents panicking and say that today there was a COVID positive patient in the outpatient, and all the resident doctors went to the director wanting to have, unless we are there, we are not working. If you don't have, there are these limits that you take care and refer the patient to an area where these are available.
Yeah.
So you don't go in and do foolhardy bravado, but you do things carefully, but with a humanism that is expected of you.
So what I understand from sir is, number one, you have to be responsible towards yourself. If you go to a war, you do carry your swords, but you do carry your shields. So just don't barge into it that I'll win it. And by shouting I'll win it, you don't win it. So the strategy is be sensible. Two strategies: keep distance, keep your hands clean. Don't raise your hands above the level of shoulder. Do not touch the mucosal surfaces, the T area, as sir has clearly told. But most important thing, we are going to be responsible for our patients. We can't shy away from it, never ever. We are never happy if we don't save lives. And if we are careful, we can make a difference. And trust me, our government and the authorities are going to try to get everything possible to control this virus. And we have been seeing that. The second thing, sir.
No, I remember during the HIV epidemic, early stages, I was an activist during that period, and many surgeons were so petrified of operating a patient of HIV positive. And I did many of them very safely because I knew what are the precautions where I have sharps likely to injure me. So I learned my surgical technique in a manner and did my surgery in a manner that protected me as well as it protected the patient. So you need to understand what is required and work with that safety norms.
Very good. And if
but don't panic.
Yeah, don't panic. But if those safety things are not available and you have to do procedures, you're not doing them without the PPE. Make sure that those are there. Otherwise, the patients are respectfully transmitted to the areas with the proper equipment. But the second thing, sir.
Everyone is not emotionally built the same way.
Right.
Some are emotionally mature. Some are not so mature. So it is normal again. Don't think he is sissy. So therefore he chickened out and I am brave. Therefore I am doing something brave. No. It's a normal human being. 10% of people may be very, very scared and may have panic. Those are the times when you need to go to a senior whom you trust, you can talk to, and who understands the disease process so that he can counsel you to get back on job. Our job is patient care and we must fulfill it, taking care of the patient even as we take care of ourselves.
And every doctor has a responsibility wherever he gets a chance to spread positivity in this testing time. At your home, people are getting depressed. Motivate them. Spend time with them, but give them positive words. Tell them discussing about the same thing is not going to yield anywhere. Let us be scientific. Let us try to take precautions, but let us try to spend time together in positive environment. Even as a doctor, apart from your duty hours, you should be home observing the norms of creating that distance and that roaming around in the society. And here comes a very important word which sir would not like to listen, the social distancing term. And I know that he would like to put in some words in on this word of social distancing, which actually, is it a correct word or not? Let's hear from his mouth.
Well, it's unfortunate. When you use the term social, it's got used, it's picked up internationally, all over the world you have the word. And the moment I heard the word, it struck me as something odd. In our societies, we already have social distancing of so many kinds of people. I don't want to name them.
Right.
We have classes of social distancing. We have races of social distancing. We have ethnics, communities where social distancing is the norm and people have been stigmatized by social distancing. We don't want that to be extended for this disease, which is actually happening.
Right.
Doctors caring for in hospitals, they're not being given homes to live in. They're being thrown out of homes. That stigma is not good. All that we need to do is human distancing. Space between two human beings. Don't say social distancing. Human distancing between two people so that the spread of the virus is eliminated.
It's so important to understand this aspect. The second point comes to other society. We doctors are trying to work our best to help out everybody. It's our responsibility. But then there has to be a compassion in the heart of each person in this country to see us with respect and at least not rise to the level that sir just mentioned. We have been reading out that there are some landlords who have asked to vacate their places. Imagine. Now if you do that, who are going to save you? What type of people will save you if you do this to the doctors of the nation? Now this is the time where the citizens of the country should realize that it is the health professionals who are right now fighting it out for you. And then you have to yourself be responsible that you stay at home, observe the proper precautions, do not move out, and specifically if you have young kids in first decade and then you have elderly at home beyond seventh decade or so, that is more than 60 years. This is one thing that you should make sure that the young people, even if they have to go out, they need to ask these questions. Do I need to really go out? Second, if I go out, which is the time I should go out when the least amount of people will be on the road? Third, what are the essential things I need to buy? What am I going it out for? And try to live on minimum and try to save things. I hope that this COVID virus just goes away. I pray as a doctor, I pray as a citizen of my nation. But I really want to tell everybody here that you have a time at home to talk to your parents, to spend with your kids, value it. And then have a positive frame of mind on all the social medias, spread good things, talk positive. Because in testing times, if we hold hands of each other, this time will pass by and we'll surely come out better. Sir.
Just to add on to that, landlords throwing out doctors, that's also a panic reaction out of ignorance. So they don't know. So I would look at it positively that how do we go around it? So the government fortunately has come out with a policy.
Yes.
They have clearly stated that no doctor would be evicted from his premises or healthcare worker will be evicted from his premises because of this, and they are coming out with some rules regarding this.
Yes.
So the government is with you on this. So I would certainly say do not panic. If you are panicking, please understand is the landlord is also panicking. So we understand human beings have emotional. I would rather deal with an emotional being than a cold-blooded terrorist who is irrational. I would rather have somebody who panics, but we need to overcome our panics with a positivity and knowledge of what can be done.
So let doctors be with each other and let the community of the entire population of the country be with the doctors. Let's together fight it out. And one thing that we realize here, if we stay at home, the incidence of the disease, the prevalence of the disease can be controlled. And if we stay at home, the so-called mortality which the disease is associated with can be brought down. So some final words of positivity, sir, before we close it down.
We have a new virus. We are understanding. Use this opportunity to study every literature that you can get. Incidentally, many portals have come out with a free access to any literature on coronavirus. Many Elseviers and others, Scopus, they have all come out with free access to the literature. Use this opportunity to understand about viruses, understand about the epidemiology, understand the spread of the virus, and every negative thing, try to see what you can learn from it. Here is a golden opportunity. A situation like this has never happened in our lifetime and in many lifetimes. Here is an opportunity for you to learn, to understand. It also gives us a time to reflect and get back to our understanding of a relationship with human beings, with nature.
And I hope that I will finish the lines with, Hum honge kamyaab, man mein hai vishwas, pura hai vishwas, hum honge kamyaab, aur agar hum ek dusre ke saath rehte hain, we are with each other, I am sure we'll come out from this situation. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.